Okay, we're moving into Studio A now. Okay, we are entering Studio A.
I'm rolling.
Have you been here before, Jim?
I have, but it's been 15 years, maybe more.
We're going to walk into loud yelling here.
Check, one, two.
You remember this room?
Yeah. This is the main studio.
This is the main room.
We're just going to readjust.
Yeah, whatever you want to do. Some people like to rock, some people like to roll. But me, I like to sit around and dance on my soul. Rock the women hard, I like my women dry. When all I want to do is move and let it all roll.
Alright, from the top.
I'm Jim Jarmusch. I'm an artist, I guess, a filmmaker, writer, a musician, and an art and music lover. Today, man, I'm going to guide you through a one-of-a-kind experience. I'm at Electric Lady, one of the most iconic recording studios in music history. Jimi Hendrix built it in 1970, and it's nestled on 8th Street here in New York's Greenwich Village. So to celebrate the 50th anniversary of this remarkable studio, Electric Lady and Spotify have partnered together to create Live at Electric Lady, a new concert series where you will experience different hosts and artists spending the day together in the studio, hanging out, and creating. You'll experience the band's recording process while covering an iconic song, originally done at Electric Lady, then followed by an intimate live show and an interview with me. So as you can imagine, you're in for a real treat. I'll be your host on this episode, and we'll get to spend some time with the raconteurs.
Maybe piano on that part, too. What do you want to do? Are you going to sing right there?
I think you should sing the song.
The whole thing?
Yeah.
Are you going to do the intro then? You want me to do that too?
Maybe I'll just join in on some stuff, right?
Okay.
I don't know.
This stuff doesn't faze me.
Well, you know, and the choruses. I belong to the... Maybe.
Okay.
I think you just sound better.
Like, Danny, can I get a pencil or something? Can I get like a pencil or something like potato chips?
I've been a longtime fan of the raconteurs. They're a very interesting mix of people from different bands that I love, and they're made up of old friends. Jack White and Jack Lawrence of the Dead Weather, with Patrick Keeler and Jack Lawrence of the Greenhorns, and of course, Brendan Benson. I've known them for well over 15 years. We're all from the same tribe in some way, and I've always had a special connection with these guys.
Yeah.
How many of those knobs did you actually use?
When the raconteurs made their first album, Broken Boy Soldier, they asked me to do the first video for Steady As She Goes. And back then, Jack's spirit brought me back into music when he gave me a beautiful Gibson acoustic guitar from 1905 at the end of our video shoot. And I said, no, Jack, no way, I'm not taking that guitar. And he says, hey man, I have two of them. If I had one, I would never give it to you. Before that, I hadn't played for almost 20 years, but after Jack gave me that guitar, I started my own band, Squirrel.
How's that reverb sound? It's not real.
Then it sounds like shit. Then.
Should I?
The Voidoids track that originally here, right?
There's three different versions of that song, to my knowledge, all recorded at three different studios.
Wow.
And we were the second recording.
That's Lee, the manager and partner of Electric Lady. While the band was recording, Lee and I were in the control room watching the guys do their thing. Joined, of course, by the sound engineers Jack Mason and William Garrett.
I'm rolling.
Okay. Still a little bit fast, I think.
Some people like to rock, some people like to roll.
It was in this same room, Studio A, where Richard Hell and the Voidoids recorded Blank Generation, which the Rock on Tours will cover tonight.
I belong to the Blank Generation, and I can take it or leave it each time. Well, I belong to the generation, but...
The song was first released as a single in 1976 on Ork Records.
So how about here, like, first verse, chorus, second verse, chorus.
The ooze.
Then there's a solo and then the ooze.
Solo ooze.
Solo after each chorus, right?
Yeah.
This might be the most well-arranged punk song.
I know, yeah.
But this song didn't originate as a punk song. The origins of this song go way back to 1959. Blank Generation is actually a rewrite of Beat Generation, a song by Bob McFadden, a singer and actor from the 50s, and co-written with the American poet Rod McEwen.
I run around in sandals, I never ever shave, and that's the way I want to be when someone digs my grave.
Put a beat in the White House.
I belong to the Beat Generation, yeah. I don't let anything trouble my mind.
Sneaky Pete. Yeah.
Is this like an episode of This Old House or something?
I want to show you the open floor plan. And the new siding is remarkable.
I once knew a man who worked from 9 to 5. Just to pay his monthly bills was why he stayed alive. So keep your
this guy's naked.
He's naked.
Look at this.
I want to get some of this. Come on over.
I'm not sure how this works.
I had no idea that Blank Generation was based on another song until Jack told me the story of how he found the record.
So how did you guys, how much time did you spend preparing Blank Generation?
How long did it take to get over here?
In the cab on the way over here. Dave Buick from Third Man Records, him and I a long time ago went record shopping. We bought a bunch of 45s and that was one of them, said Beat Generation on it. I guess they're doing like a novelty record making fun of beatniks. Like, hey, Weirdsville, Daddy-O, Weirdsville.
I belong to the Beat Generation, and everything's going just fine.
Weirdsville, yeah. Something
we didn't know what it was, and we were just playing it in his living room. Oh my God, this is has to be where Blank Generation came from.
Yeah.
So Richard did a rewrite of it.
I belong to the Blank Generation, and I can take it or leave it each time. Well, I belong to the generation, but I can take it or leave it.
I remember the first time I heard Blank Generation the night when he goes, I belong to the generation. He just took that breath. It didn't occur to me that he was going blank, that he was blanking. I thought he meant fill in your own generation. So that probably is incorrect, but I thought, oh, let me take that incorrect idea and feed off of that. So I was just saying, why don't I say other generations, like the Generation X and the me generation and stuff, throw that in there at the end. Does it not do the stop until the second time we sing? So it's like, I belong to the blank generation. And next time he goes, I belong to the generation. He doesn't say blank.
The filmmaker Jean-Luc Godard once said, in America you call it plagiarism. In Europe we call it homage.
That day we were lucky enough to be joined at the studio by Richard Gotterer, the original producer of Blank Generation.
Who would have thought that 42 years ago,
I haven't looked this way,
and they were back here and doing the same crappy song?
Richard told us that just the other day while he was on the subway, he was thinking that it was time for someone to cover Blank Generation for the new generations. So the timing couldn't be better.
I don't know what to do there, man. Am I gonna go? The last one, am I going?
Yeah.
No, 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 no.
Is that it? Yeah, I think.
All right. From the top. Always loved that guitar part. Never really sat down and said exactly figure out what he's doing. How amazing for Ivan to show up and show us how to do it.
So cool.
Ivan Julian is one of the original guitarists of the Voidoids, and he also came to see the guys record that day. As Jack mentioned before, this is a pretty well-arranged punk song, but the guitar intro is quite unusual. So it was really cool to get Ivan and Jack together to compare notes.
I wrote this part of it. It's a takeoff on an old, like, blues kind of thing. It's like...
It's not your fault.
Oh.
Just a hammer on it. That's it.
Okay.
Yeah, okay.
No more wondering, are you going... Are you going CB?
Ah.
No, we thought you were going to be able to
do that. Right. I saw you do that. I saw you do that.
Thanks for showing us that, man.
That's awesome.
We should have called you yesterday.
I'm sorry, dude.
No, my fault.
I've always been intrigued about how certain rock bands can be messy, but at the same time, very sophisticated.
I sort of find one or the other in rock and roll more recently. But you have a kind of effortless way of allowing those things to coexist, and I don't know what kind of question that is to ask musicians.
That's probably what makes the sound of our band more unique is because of Brendan bringing that to us. You know, what I was doing, what the Greenhorns were doing, what he were doing. This band is kind of a combination of those three things. His craftsmanship, his more attention to detail, my more shoot from the hip thing, and their kind of swing that they have to them.
As a band, how conscious are you of channeling things that come through you that you're not imitating? The way you and Brendan work vocally, there's a genetic almost thing where your voices work by not being distinctly, vastly different. Mm. And it's very beautiful. And you do the same with your guitar lines. And these two guys, they are like one of my favorite rhythm sections forever, you know? So they have something between them, and then you guys all feel that, you know?
You're sort of almost describing how the band kind of came together. It was me and Brendan wanting to work together, want to write songs together. And, well, maybe we could bring in the rhythm section from the Greenhorns and record some of this stuff. And that turned into the Rag and Jury, that turned into the band. It's sort of like, oh wow, I didn't even think of that when we first talked about it. If I was gonna sit down and write out how to make a band, I would pick, I wanna write songs with Brendan, and I would love to have those guys as the rhythm section. There's the band. Yeah. We didn't decide yet, but you know, it just happened by accident anyway, so.
What Jack said stuck with me. Sometimes great things in art happen unexpectedly while you're creating something genuine. And there's a lot of beauty and magic in that.
Just a quick question about the creative process. It's a mystery where it comes from. How do you protect it from outside forces, from the world of marketing, from, you know, just the evil things that affect it, because it's what you do. It's your job. It's why you're here, because you guys are musicians and artists, and so that's what you're supposed to do.
We were a little bit luckier in one aspect where we kind of came up making records in a time period where people were letting the artists do what they wanted to a little bit more in the music realm, because I think it could be redone easily. Back in the 50s and 60s, studio time was expensive and precious, and some albums were done in 3 hours, you know, and that was it. And the record label picked the album cover photo, pick the name of the album, pick the name of your band, probably, all that stuff, what songs you were gonna do and all that. But we came up in an area like, no, you guys are writing the songs and you do what you wanna do and you present it to. But we also weren't signed to major labels where they were really telling us, no, this is not good enough. We had to be our own bosses. It was the best thing for me because shot me to be more on my own case, get on my own back about something being good enough. But I think it's almost a disease too, that a lot of the independent artist stuff don't have anybody tapping them on the shoulder. So they don't learn that trick that you gotta do that to yourself. You gotta be on your own case.
I think Jack learned the trick, and proof of that is Third Man Records, the independent record label he founded in 2011. Actually, the latest Rock on Tour's record, Help Us Stranger, was recorded at Third Man Studios in Nashville.
That seemed better, right?
Yeah, that seemed pretty good. Should we listen and see if there's anything we need to...
I was lucky because Jack sent me an advanced copy of the new record on a CD that I think he burned himself. Before this album, the guys hadn't made anything together in over 10 years, and 10 years is a long time.
So how did the hiatus work for you guys? Because it seems like it had no effect, really, at least not a negative one.
That's wild. It's crazy how we just, I think a couple days into the studio, it felt like only a couple weeks had passed.
Yeah. Getting it back together, maybe we were all like in our heads a little bit more. How's it going to go? Like, it's been a long time. Like, is it going to go okay? Or is it going to take a while to get us back on track and the wheels rolling?
He was tied up that entire time, though. Those 10 years, he was tied up in my basement. And I kept yelling at him, write some songs.
That was so important. You know, like,
it was important to us as a group, but to him, he was very patient. That's the problem. You can't tie a guy like him up. He's so patient. He'll just wait it up.
I've written the fifth album. We just need to get there.
Is that called patience?
The technology hadn't caught up to his fifth album that he's written for us.
I see.
That's how patient he is. It's a testament to his patience.
Stop the gramophone and check out how Celeste applies. I belong to the blank generation. I can take it all, even if it's time.
Let's go put some finished vocals on.
Okay.
I was saying let me out of here, for I was even born such a gambler when you get a face.
Jack, let me know when you're ready. We're set.
Yeah, let's go from the top.
Okay, we're gonna roll from the top.
Yeah, I belong to Generation X, and I don't let anything trouble my mind. I belong to the me generation, and everything's gonna be just fine. I belong to Generation Z. What's that you said? What's that you say to me? Did you say something?
Love it. Love it. Great. Thank you.
Filmmaking is a lot like recording because you can do a take over, you can adjust it, you're gathering the tracks. So in the studio, how do you approach it? Do you get a feeling of the room?
Today, for example, is a lot of people in the room. It's probably like 40 people walking around working. And when I was in my 20s, that would have driven me crazy. I would not be able to do that in front of people. To me, I just couldn't imagine. Like, this is like, how can you be real and come from the heart and shoot from the hip and all that with so many people in the mix to mess it up. But now I'm older and it could be 200 more people in the room. I can deal with that in a different way.
How's it going?
I think it helps me with people in the room.
Have you ever tried the experiment? I've tried where you have like 8 guys in a room and you bring one pretty girl in the room. You could change the vibe so fast, you know? I would say like, bring your mom and put your mom in the control room.
You guys, Brendan and LJ, you want to do, come on, do the ooze?
Yeah.
Double the ooze,
maybe? Ooze box.
One more time.
Ready to go when you are.
Okay, here we go.
It's been over 40 years since I saw the Voidoids originally perform Blank Generation at CBGB's. So how cool to be able to watch this fantastic version unfold here at Electric Lady and to see and hear that legacy continue.
rap boys.
And we just have to do it again in 2 hours.
That's right.
But in the reverse direction.
Exactly.
So you recorded, now you're going to kind of shift gears and do a small show, but now you're going to play live for an audience. What do you feel about the shifting gears? And
apparently they found a box of acid tabs that we're giving the entire crowd tonight without their knowledge. You know, that without Folgers Crystal thing where they're like, you don't know you're drinking Folgers Crystal? It's going to be that kind of thing at the end.
The Rock on Tour.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
After the first performance, I felt really moved. There was a lot of energy going on, and it makes sense because there's so much history to this place. I arrived early and was lucky enough to get a quick tour from Lee.
When Hendrix built the place, this was going to be his sort of flagship space. And of course, he died very soon after opening the
place. Yeah, he only recorded for 10 weeks, I think.
Probably my favorite historical moment in this room is that David Bowie and John Lennon wrote and recorded Fame in this room on the fly.
Ah, what a room.
And of course, you know these old murals, these have been here for almost, I mean, they've been here for, we're 49 years old now, so they've been hanging right there for almost 5 decades.
Jimmy's space vibe, right?
We were inside the vehicle, and these are all albums that we've worked on, and this is Studio D. That's a student model Rhodes from the mid-70s.
Oh, it is. Mm-hmm.
I've got a picture of Dylan playing that thing.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow.
It's changed a lot just since I've been here 15 years, and the whole look of it's changed completely. There was the old theater here, too, that, you know, the 8th Street Cinema that was shared this building with us.
I don't remember even being in the theater, but I certainly remember the marquee and it being here. I bet Patti Smith had tea up here before.
I'm sure she has, yeah.
Electric Lady was like a club since the 30s, before a studio was
built. I didn't know that. I don't know.
And maybe it's my imagination, but I still feel, you know, molecular musical things.
You're right.
Like ghosts. Yeah,
they can repaint it, and then, you know, whatever magical things are happening when you're creating music that nobody knows what they are, that they just, wow, how all of a sudden that sounded good. No one knows why, and no one could even bother to, anyone thinks they can explain it or being ridiculous. No,
and you're a conduit. You're walking around. You're an artist, so you're just sort of, you know, reacting to all of these, you know, molecules, right, all the time.
Well,
and so you come into a place like this, and it's like you're overloaded with, like, oh, you know.
It's vibrating.
A lot of great minds have been through this place. Mm.
Daft Punk, use this table.
This is my first time here at Electric Lady Studios. Pretty stoked. Stoked about that. It's definitely some molecules, as Jim likes to say, in the air. There's something kind of spooky. Only child, only son, treated like a criminal ever since day one. Only child, where do you go? And are you coming back again? 'Cause no one wants to know. Only child, one of these days, someone's gonna come around, try to make you change. Only child, sensitive soul, you see the beauty in everything without ever being told. About leaving you once or twice, leaving it all behind, never think twice. Well, somewhere far away on a beach sounds nice. Nothing on my mind, nothing on my mind. Only child, the prodigal son, has come back home again to get his laundry done. Thank you.
somewhere far away on a beach sounds nice. Nothing on my mind. Nothing on
Over the years, the Rock on Tours have performed and recorded a number of fascinating covers. So I was curious about their process and how they approach making cover versions. Do you just find what you love about it and then just do you not overthink it?
One thing I always try over the years in like different projects was, let's just cover anything and get the train rolling and get our brains working. So if you start off with a cover, it sort of takes all the pressure off of anything. It's not like you're, oh, let's start off with the best song I wrote this month. First thing in the studio, first day. Mm. Only problem with that technique is what usually happens is everyone's excited and you end up getting a really good take of a cover song, like we did with Hey Jip on the album. We ended up putting it on our album because we liked it so much. But it was really just a Kickstarter technique.
What's the first song on the new album?
That's Borden. Like,
yeah, and the very opening, the drum part.
Yeah, it's very like a kind of jazz intro.
But it made me laugh out loud, I gotta say. Because the first time I heard the record, you know, I got the record from Jack before it was out or whatever. And when I first put it on.
Give me $100, I'll give you the cash.
I burst out laughing though, because it was so fun, you know? Mm. And it was like, hey, Patrick, who the hell would play that? Who would think that up?
I mean, everyone who's a musician on stage is doing something that they love and they're trying to share it with someone else. Some people fall in the trap of it being about authenticity, but I don't think it's about that. I think it's about, attitude is probably a better word than authenticity. The attitude of what you did was the best part, not whether you got all the notes right, but whether your point of what you were trying to accomplish was evident to us in the crowd.
Anyone like that has gotten somewhere that you feel something from, it's their personalities coming out through it. Like, we're funny guys.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So we're not going to take it all seriously, but we're serious about rock and roll too, you know, so that's going to show.
I understand you're all our top listeners. That's how it was described to me. And I want to say thank you very much. That's awesome. Thank you. I also want to say, if you call me, I'll come running. You can call me anytime. These 16 strings we're strumming, they're gonna back up every line. If you call me, I'll come running. You can call me anytime. And these 16 strings are strumming, they will back up every line. There's a motivation about you that must have been here apart. And it takes my affection, and it wants to break my heart. Break my heart. Help a stranger, help me get it off my mind. Get me back on my feet, mother, can you spare the time? Help me stranger, help me get it off my mind. Get me back on my feet, but I can't spare the time. It's not essential that I hear you, but it's a sensitive device. Reverential when I hear you, and I hear you.
I can reflect to your advice. Well, I wish I had the words, and I wish those words were mine. And I wish I had the nerve, 'cause I sure don't have the time. Help me, stranger, help me get it off my mind. Get me back on my feet, but I can't spare the time. Help me, stranger, get it out of my mind. Get back on my feet, but I can't spare the time. But I can't spare the time. But I can't spare the time. But I can't spare the time.
Thank you.
Well, how do you feel in general about the state of rock and roll now? Or do you just do what you do and not
I think it does this over the years, you know? It's like, you know, punk comes out, then in the 80s it takes a dip down, and grunge comes out, and then it takes a dip down, and the garage rock scene that White Stripes and the Strokes were part of, that comes out, and it takes a dip down. I think the internet's delayed it, though. You know, it's things are a lot more confusing now and a lot more information at everyone's fingertips now. You can be into so many things. You just click on the internet and you can get into Indian music, Mexican music, you know, all kinds of stuff at an early age, which is amazing, you know.
Rock is a difficult genre to define these days. All I know is I'm thankful we have the Rock on tours.
And Queens of the Stone Age.
You look pretty in your fancy dress, but I detect unhappiness. You don't speak, so I have to guess you're not free.
As an artist, I believe that having different forms of creative expression is important because, in the end, they all cross-reference each other in some way. You know, like Patrick's like a motocross dirt bike star, and you're an adult film star.
Mm-hmm. Knife juggling.
Knife juggling.
Mm-hmm.
Brendan, I don't even want to ask
what
he's building in his basement. You know,
I think it's important to have different, you know, outlets, and also there. you know, it's like athletes, you know, even if you're a baseball player, it's a good thing to play, you know, once in a while play some basketball.
And a lot of the artists I respect, it's not surprising to show up and see them being creative in some other way. And even if it's cooking or something like that, you just think,
yeah.
I think there's a misconception that artists, they sit down and nuggets or they choose, I'm going to be this kind of artist. I think it's more like we don't have any control over this.
You got your own little thing going on, Jim.
Your band's core.
Well, I make collages, I write stuff. Right, I try to do a lot of things because I don't do any of them well.
You gave up serial killing after
that
a while?
That I was good at.
Yeah.
You guys are fantastic, and I just love how you protect what you do, and you obviously don't let the fuckers get you.
That's right.
So, you know.
Likewise, man.
What great things you do. It's important to protect your art, and these days, especially from the straight-up marketeers. For them, the value is temporary, and it can only be evaluated by money. The great poet William Blake said over 250 years ago, "The evaluation of art by money is unacceptable." And in other words, don't let the fuckers get you.
Yeah.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks for listening. Thanks, Spotify. Thank you very much. Thank you, Electric Lady.
Being at Electric Lady with the Raconteurs did take me back in time to the New York of the 70s, back when music was being created in a new and personal way, a raw way, a kind of amateurism. And by that, I mean that as a compliment. To me, amateur, the word comes from a Latin root meaning love. In that way, the Raconteurs are true amateurs. The music they make comes from a deep love that they have for the form, for rock and roll. I would just like to add that I was so very happy to spend time at Electric Lady with Jack, Brendan, Patrick, Little Jack, Dean. They are all such wonderful people and really great musicians. This was really a blast.
You had to, Jack. Could you make it to that truck?
Oh, we could make it to that truck pretty easy, I think.
And if you made it to that truck, would it just
throw you running?
I bet that would collapse in. You would fall. The aluminum would
easily.
And then, at the end of the night, me and the guys debated how to survive a jump from the roof. What a day.
They're not made for waves. They're just made for, like, people just for rain. It's just for rain, yeah.
Brendan says, get back there, no problem.
No problem.
I could land on a moving motorcycle. No problem.
In fact, I've done it before.